Hi everybody, it's Dr. Domingo. I hope you are doing well. I thought I would provide this short video for you for tips on your third paper that's coming up. And so by evidence of what I saw last time when I provided a video, I saw really good papers on here. So I thought I'd do the same thing for your third and upcoming paper, which is the Financial Procedures Guide. That is due Sunday on or before 11:59. Okay, so what I want to cover, and this is going to be a short video, is just a quick review of our class over the past 2.5 months, over the past 10 modules. I want to cover then just putting it all together and really the implications from this class is what does it mean to be a leader in the nonprofit financial arena? Finally, and of course apropos to this video, is your upcoming paper and what I expect to see. So MAL 568 is about really being a leader in the nonprofit space, specifically in the area of financial management. And when you first took the class, when you first signed up for it, I know some of you were saying, "Oh man, I don't understand finances or accounting," and that's okay. I think the whole purpose of the course is to introduce you to the major financial concepts that nonprofit leaders are going to face. And just by being aware of them and knowing them, knowing some of the skills and tools you use, it'll help you be a more effective leader in this realm. So you can think of this class being divided into three parts, and Part 1, 2, and 3 here, fiscal issues, fiscal health, and fiscal procedures. Now, each of these sections correspond, interestingly, to the three papers that you wrote. So in this first part, fiscal issues, we covered what it's like to consider nonprofits as a business. That is, what makes nonprofits specific to being a business versus a for-profit organization, and thinking of it in business terms. And so we also looked at some of the internal and external issues that impact the finances of nonprofits, things like financial regulation or laws or economics. Sometimes social events come up that prompt people to give more. And so disaster relief is a great example of when a natural disaster strikes, you see a lot of giving and relief giving. We then turned our attention in the middle part of the course. We spent some modules specifically on looking at accounting. We looked at reports, we looked at financial statements, things like the balance sheet, the statement of income or cash flow statement. We looked at a thing called the 990 form. And I think this was, from my perspective, one of the funnest parts of the class because I think in nonprofit financial management, you're exposed to a lot of different financial statements, and how do you make sense out of all of them? And there's a great series of videos that we shared during this time called Finance Unlocked for Nonprofits, and I hope that was helpful to give you a sense of what to look for and how to read some of these financial statements. And so as you continue to journey into the nonprofit space, you will encounter these different financial statements, and hopefully this has provided you with a little bit more skill on what to look for, how to analyze them and such. The 990 form is, obviously a tax form, and who would have thought that you'd have fun looking at tax forms? Well, this was a great module on that, and so I provided some resources along that line. Now, in this part two section as well, we looked at things like budgeting and cash flow and what to look for managing a nonprofit organization well. That is, just don't spend more money than you take in. But simple things like that. Beyond that, it's things like thinking about the strategic plan of the organization and what does it mean to put money into a program. Did you think strategically about it? Does it make sense in light with the mission and vision for the organization? And finally, toward the third part of the course, the latter third, we looked at, or we are looking at, internal controls, risk management, and ethics. So how do you piece this all together, and how do you ensure that the financial side of the nonprofit is well maintained and well run? So that's a quick jaunt and summary of our course. Again, I hope it's been helpful. But here are my three takeaways, if you will, and I've grouped them again by our three parts. So If you think about it, the first part with financial or fiscal issues is that whether it's a for-profit or even the nonprofit space, it is still about managing resources effectively. Just because a nonprofit is called that doesn't mean that it cannot be led and managed financially well. So the fallacy is that in nonprofit you don't have to worry about finances because they're not concerned about profit. Well, that's the furthest thing from the truth. You want to still be responsible and manage the organization effectively, because if you don't have any money, you can't run your programs. So that is critical. Fiscal health, the key takeaway there in that section is that knowing how to read a financial statement, it really is a skill. So I encourage you, go to the 990 sites, take a look at financial statements of organizations, try to analyze them and dissect them and see what conclusions you can make, because once you get into it, it's actually pretty fun, and you can learn a lot just about the organization even without knowing what they do, but just on how they manage their money. The other thing is that budgeting is ultimately a moral decision. It's really a decision on where an organization puts its finances, where it feels that it should prioritize its activities. So beyond the numbers itself of budgeting, it really is about where the organization thinks they can make the most impact. So that principle is a great takeaway from that. Finally, in part three, the fiscal procedures, you want to always protect yourself and do not take risks without knowing the consequences. I think it's always important to protect yourself and think about the actions that you're going to take in a nonprofit, especially from the financial sense, because every sort of resource that's spent is not necessarily going to come back. And so you have to think about, as a leader, what does it mean to put your money in this certain area, and to know things like, if you get revenue, how do you manage it? Who's going to manage it? Who's going to sign the checks? Who's going to ensure that there's no fraud involved? That kind of thing. And this ultimately means that your reputation will also impact your finances. So we've seen so many financial scandals in the nonprofit sphere. And so, nonprofit financial reputation, it goes a long way in terms of acquiring donations and resources for the future. So those are some key takeaways from this course. Again, ultimately, nonprofit financial management is about being a leader and cognizant and knowledgeable with the skills and attitudes it takes to run that finance area well. Okay. Let's talk about your upcoming paper, and this is the third and final paper, which is the Financial Procedures Guide. I provided this slide as an outline for what to expect in this paper, and again, please, feel free to pause and take a look at this, because this is taken from the rubric. Obviously, the rubric is the end-all, so I encourage you to download the rubric and take a look at it and answer the questions on there. So first, you want a good introduction to your organization. Now, the organization must be different from before, so you cannot use one that you have used in a previous paper. Obviously, you'll give some background, what they do, their history, a little bit about their leadership, vision of the organization, that kind of thing. But I also want you to cite the sources that you got this information from. So if you're hearing it secondhand, you want to get the source. And so whether that's the website, whether that's an annual report, do provide that, because it's always interesting to find out where these organizations come from and what their sources are. So cite the sources where you got that. Now, here's where you're starting to get into the paper. Why is financial management important? You want to discuss why it's important, not just in general. I mean, obviously, it's good because it'll help your nonprofit survive. That's a simple answer. But why specifically for this organization? Given what you just said about the organization, why is it important to manage their finances well? So that's a quick section on that. But the most important section is going to come in the guide. Now, when the paper asks you to write a financial guide, I want you to write it in a way that incorporates some of the language from a financial guide. In the wrap-up video, I think I have talked a little bit about the fact that you can go ahead and Google a nonprofit financial guide. take a look at the different sections in there. You'll find that there are sections on internal controls. You'll find that there are sections on policy and procedures. So I want you to include the detail of that policy. So for example, you know, how to take in revenue. So you're going to write something about how revenue is generated, whether that is via donations, contributions, grants, whatnot, and the procedures for handling the monies. So what happens if the organization gets a grant? Who's going to handle the money? How do they do the banking? What financial statements will they be using to measure the financial health of the organization? What internal controls? Ideally, you want to have a section with these major sections in it. So a section of this guide will have subsections, whether it's revenue, financial statements, internal controls. You decide what those sections are going to be, but I want to see detail on what is done. So just as if you were a new board member coming in and you were given a financial guide, I want you to write that. Okay, so try to integrate everything we've talked about with good financial management and put that into this guide. Now, the other part is you want to talk about the significance of each section. What's the importance of including a section on internal controls, for example? You can either discuss this in the guide itself, or you can put this as a separate section in your paper. So again, when I use the word the guide, it's going to be a section of your paper. But the significance of the sections could be another section talking about the guide. Hope that makes sense. All right, so I want you to remember the important thing is APA. It is important. I will start looking at this in greater detail, but this means a title page and abstract reference pages are included. Be sure those are separate. Page breaks, meaning that they start the page by itself. They are not part of a page or not, you know, that's in the narrative section. So those are three extra pages in addition to the text or narrative section of the paper as well. Now, remember your formatting needs to be correct. This means your margins have to be according to APA. Your fonts, don't choose crazy fonts, that kind of thing. 1-inch margins all the way around. Just be sure you adhere to that. Make sure your writing is clear. And so you want to see Chapter 3 of the APA manual, because this is a really good section on writing clearly, concisely, and also there is a sample paper in the APA manual. I always remind students, take a look at that sample paper, because the formatting, the writing, how things are laid out, that is a good template and example to use. All right. The final thing is, do you answer the question you were asked? The content addresses the rubric. So when you write out the paper, have the rubric next to you so you can look at it and answer the question. You'll see that it's a pretty straightforward paper. If you divide it into sections, you'll have five sections, your intro, your three sections of the paper, and then a conclusion. So pretty straightforward. Just answer the question and you'll be fine. I hope that's helped. And again, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to contact me. I hope this video has helped. I know it helped the last time. I saw some great writing on your last paper, and I expect the same for this. So thanks again, and don't hesitate to contact me, and I'll see you online.